The production of this video was made possible by donors to the Orchestration Online Patreon initiative. Please consider adding your support to the creation of free educational internet resources by visiting our Patreon page linked below.
Hey there, this is your orchestration tutor, Thomas Goss. If you've watched my previous video about parts paper sizes, then you're ready for this video covering what orchestra librarians want you to know about formatting and page turns. This is really such an involved topic that I've split the information across two videos. But as you'll see, all the different strands of information are so interrelated that they should still be thought of as a single chapter of this video series. Don't be intimidated by the very technical-sounding word, formatting. As you'll see in this video, a lot of decisions made in formatting your parts are due to very practical human considerations by the musicians on behalf of you, the composer or arranger. The players want to sound their best when they take on your work in rehearsal and performance, so it's important for you to understand the logic underlying all the options available to you. For instance, once you know the paper size that the orchestra prefers, the next step is to think about readability. How are you going to populate the given dimensions of each page with instructions to the musicians? Here, the orchestra librarian wants you to think about the simple challenges presented in reading a sheet of paper off a music stand. Because here's where we composers and orchestrators can get into trouble by printing up a sample sheet and assuming that since it looks good to us on our piano rack or computer desk, it'll be fine for the orchestral musician. However, different musicians sit at different distances from their music stands, and in all likelihood a bit further away and at a lower angle than a pianist reading off of a typical piano music rack. Woodwind players probably sit the closest to their music stands, as their instruments usually don't require a lot of space, and each player gets their own stand. They can easily reach forward to turn a part, sometimes even while playing half their instrument, as with this flute player from the Franz Liszt Weimar Academy Orchestra. Harp players usually have the music stand within easy reach of their left arm, as their ability to lean forward is limited by their large instruments. Brass players usually like a bit more distance, as their instruments take more space than winds, especially the heavy brass. Distances start to widen from there with string players. Since each music stand, or desk as it's called in the string section, is usually shared between a pair of players, this necessitates its placement a little further away so that both players can read the music. This gap increases as the size of each instrument positions pairs of players progressively further apart. Cellists have stands further away from them, and bassists possibly even further. Percussionists may end up with even more space between their eyes and the music on their stands. Some simple setups like a snare drum or a suspended cymbal may take up very little room, but other setups may require the music stand to sit at quite a distance from the player, such as with timpani or kit drums. It's almost a given that a kit drum part will have numerous instructions to the player, many of which are unreadable should the composer or copyist choose a smaller staff size, at the distance the drummer has to sit from their music stand. This is why it's so essential to aim for a universal staff size that's easy to read for any of these players. For the smallest allowable paper sizes of 9 by 12 inches, or metric A4, this would be 0.28 to 0.29 inches, or 7 to 7.5 millimeters. For the medium range papers I mentioned in the last video, booklet from Super Tabloid or SRA3, 0.29 to 0.31 inches or 7.5 to 8 millimeters is best. And for the very generous parts paper sizes of 11 by 14 inches or B4, a staff size of 0.31 to 0.33 inches or 8 to 8.5 millimeters is perfectly appropriate. What's interesting here is that when you put a ruler up against staves in a variety of instrument parts, the difference between 7mm and 8mm doesn't seem all that big. But every millimeter matters, especially the further the music stand is positioned away from the player. Nevertheless, I'd avoid putting too large of a staff size on too small a page size, because the result is usually a lower density of information on each page, and thus more page turns for the musicians. While it's great to assume that every part will be readable by every player if the staves are the right size, it's worth pointing out that some recording orchestras request that lower string parts be increased in staff size to facilitate reading by cellists and bassists. It's also not uncommon for percussion players to request parts with larger staff and paper sizes, especially for combined percussion scores, which I'll cover in a future video of this series. With the larger paper sizes I just mentioned, we get into questions of scaling. If the copyist takes advantage of the larger canvas, keeping the staff size around 7 to 7.5 millimeters, then a lot more information can fit into 11 by 14 inches, or metric B4 paper. But if these parts need to be reduced down someday to fit a more standard smaller paper, or even a computer tablet, then the staff size may end up far too small for musicians to read. This happens from time to time when an orchestra uses parts downloaded from IMSLP. So don't be afraid to once again scale up the staff size for very large paper in those rare instances it's called for by the librarian. But don't go above 0.35 inches, or 8.8 millimeters, or your part may end up looking like a level 1 instruction book. You can also be a bit more generous with line thickness on larger paper, which will also scale down better to a smaller paper size if need be. Another problem with scaling involves the differences between the ratios of North American and international metric paper sizes. North American parts paper sizes have an average ratio of 1 to 1.3, give or take a little between sizes, but all pretty much scalable from one to another in terms of reducing or enlarging images. International metric sizes all have the same ratio of 1 to 1.4142, even more uniform for scaling up and down. But when a metric formatted image is copied onto North American paper, it puts vertical pressure at the top and bottom of the page, while leaving a quite generous margin on the sides. Copying a North American formatted part onto metric paper results in the reverse problem, with sideways pressure on the left and right margins, and more than usual space on top and bottom. All this is allowable and certainly familiar to the musician, but it's part of the librarian's job to ensure that whatever is copied from what source onto which paper, it'll all be readable by the whole orchestra in the end. It's not inconceivable that someday you may end up formatting two different part sets for the same work, depending on which destination has ordered the parts, sometimes at the request of the librarian. One cool little footnote here is that the page size of 9.5 by 13 inches has a ratio of 1 to 1.36, which is very close to metric paper's 1 to 1.4142. So the proportions of one should scale fairly well to the other with little or no adjustment needed. That's something to think about if you're printing your own parts in North America, but sending out PDFs internationally, or vice versa. But whatever size the paper, always aim for a margin that's appropriate. MOLA recommends a minimum of 0.75 inches or 20 millimeters, no matter what size paper. But I'd reserve such a generous margin for the larger paper sizes. Most copyists and engravers would agree with me, and so would notation applications. The standard margin for smaller paper sizes is 0.59 inches, or 15 millimeters. Some freelance composers who do their own copying may use even tighter margins, down all the way to 0.47 inches, or 12 millimeters. But there has to be some kind of minimum physical space around the edges of the page to allow for binding or taping, not to mention psychological space to help the player perceive each printed image as one whole thing that doesn't visually run right into the next page at a quick glance. Parts PDFs with a standard 0.59 inch or 15 millimeter margin will scale up to 0.63 to 0.67 inches or 16 to 17 millimeters when copied from smaller paper to a mid-size paper, and up to 0.71 to 0.75 inches, or 18 to 20 millimeters on the larger papers. So this represents a good guide for margins when working above the minimum paper size. You'll have to manually set these larger margins, as notation applications don't universally increase margins when you customize the paper size. 20 millimeter margins appear on a lot of old parts from well-established repertoire. Just like large staff sizes, I'd avoid using a 20 millimeter margin on a sheet of 9 by 12 inches or A4 paper, because that might lead to many more pages per part, not to mention more page turns. But if you use a smaller margin on a large paper size, the orchestra librarian may end up printing parts with truly tiny margins if they have to scale down to the smallest paper sizes. I hope you'll forgive me if I keep coming back to scaling, but it is one of the orchestra librarian's concerns when dealing with PDFs and hard copy originals that don't match the paper size of their available stock. Also keep in mind scaling down to read on a tablet screen, or scaling up to help certain orchestral players who read the music at a greater distance. So the best strategy to deal with possible issues is to employ a graduated approach to concerns like staff size, line thickness, and margins. Scaling matters, and I'll be mentioning it in the next video as well. Speaking of which, let's end this video now while all these details are fresh in your mind. When you're ready, go on to part B of this chapter in the series, in which I'll cover the all-important topics of page flow and page turns. Hope to see you then.